Go ahead.
So my question is regarding related to the context of cyber physical social systems. So in context of that, in the Wikipedia page, there is a mention of veracity of the big data. So considering the example that when I'm thinking of a knowledge graph which updates real-time news in it, so the biggest challenge which I see there is that there is a possibility, even after if you consider the big media houses as your source of ground truth, such as BBC News, CNN, New York Times, there is a possibility that they might have a wrong data. Or sometimes even if you consider the government sources as ground truth for something related to their policies, not their policies per se, but let's say for pandemic, sometimes the government sources were reporting wrong cases. But on the other hand, at the same time, the big media houses were reporting the correct number of cases. So how do we tackle this problem of the truthness of the data which we obtain from the source
So
in this particular scenario?
the question you're asking is quite involved. It's not a simple technical answer to that. I would point out that we have a pretty significant detail, maybe 3 hours long tutorial on trust in social media. So although in this, well, the it doesn't have to be only social media, but trust in the systems, and there are multiple tutorials online. We had done a tutorial with my previous colleague TK Nara, TK Prasad, and you can find them in the Noesis SlideShare page. Now let's take your example of government, previous government reporting wrong or incorrect data on the pandemic, how many active pandemic case and things of that nature. They essentially took away the job that CDC was doing right and hired a private company that they can control under HHS, their own ministry, and said they will report the data, and they for a while did not report the data, and then they reported wrong data. The same thing happened in Florida. In particular, they had a data scientist who was reporting all the data, and they actually fired this data scientist. They raided her house and so on and so forth. So governments do this malicious thing, not just US government, many other governments in the world do these things all the time. Let's take the example of what the newspapers did or what some website did. They either relied on the fact checker websites, or they relied on, and they actually assigned a role of fact checker to a human who is supposed to look at the sources that are considered to be reliable, and based on what the reliable and also non-political or non-aligned sources, and based on that, they will mark the story as having been verified to be fact-checked, right? So these are the kind of things that you have to do to improve the trustworthiness in the data and to support the veracity aspect that you were talking about in terms of big data, the veracity of the issue. Now, the issues can become a lot more difficult. Let me tell you about if you pay attention to the talk that I shared with you, the talk I gave at Microsoft in Microsoft Faculty Summit, I talked about the so-called continuous semantics and the real data that is changing in real time. So suppose are you aware of the recent issue with small investors talking on Reddit about stock sports. What is the name of the company for which?
GameStop.
GameStop. Yeah. So and essentially you have all these people discussing issues, or basically say this stock is going to go up. Let's buy it, and we'll all make money because we are all buying it. And it went up above 400, as you may remember. Now it is, I think, below 60 or so. Maybe it was going down. Yesterday it went down to $60. you know, so in one, you know, one day, in 3 days, it lost, I don't know, 80% of the stock value. Now, what is happening here? On one, there is a reality of what is being traded in the stock market. On another hand, there is a there are big hedge funds that are shorting the stock, saying the stock price will go down. And on the third hand, there is a group of small investors betting on the stock will go up. And the point here is that let's say that somebody puts in a rumor in the Reddit thing and everybody follows. Now, people are continuously reading it and continuously taking action on this particular matter, right? So it's you really hardly have any time even to deal with, you don't have leisure to go someplace and check something and so on and so forth, right? And if you don't make a decision, your stock may be going down very fast and you lose thousands and hundreds of thousands of dollars, actually. So these are the kind of very challenging issues that are there, for which we don't have any systematic solutions, really. I can only give you a limited answer to your question, but the point is that having veracity in the data is hard enough, and then doing the veracity of real-time data and online data is even harder. I want to Okay, so I want to go here and I want to ask you guys to discuss what are the three issues I talked about. So let me ask a random person. Yong Zhao, you are taking the class. Can you turn on your video and tell me what are the three things you saw here that I talked about here? And I'm showing you the video.
I'm here.
Yeah.
Dr. Amit.
Yeah. Go ahead. So what were the three issues that I discussed here?
I'm sorry, can you repeat your question, please?
At the end of this talk, I made 3 points. I discussed 3 takeaway points. What are they?
From the last class, right?
From this video, I'm sharing this video, right? This is the video I gave on continuous semantics. I gave the example of election. I gave the example of sensor data.
Yeah, I think one of them maybe is the user privacy.
I don't think I talked about user privacy in this particular I don't think I talked about user privacy in this three things at the top thing.
I couldn't I couldn't memorize them.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Let's see. Zini Wu, I think you are also taking the class, right?
Yes.
All right. Do you remember what we talked about? What are the takeaway messages?
You mean the 3 points, right?
Yeah.
Huge, varied, and growing rapidly.
Yes.
That's it.
Yeah, guys, when we have question answer or have discussion, please turn on your video. Okay. Zia, XIA, do you remember what are the things I talked about? Zia? Okay. Also, please join in future by 12:20, 2:20 the latest. Okay. I'm going to play this and then we'll discuss.
There's no sound.
Dr. Shah, so
you can't see, you can't hear the sound. That's strange. Oh, I'm sharing the video, so I thought it should be possible. Okay, let me try out something else. Are you able to hear?
No, Dr. Shah.
Okay. So it looks like I cannot share the video. You're able to view the my screen, right?
Yes.
Okay, but you can't hear the voice. Strange. Okay, I see. Okay, I don't know. So basically, one of the things I talked about is that look, this data is growing very rapidly, right? So let me ask a very simple question. I said you can't search and find such data easily. Why is that the case?
Since the data is huge and there might be a lot of matching results.
You're looking for as well.
I'm sorry?
Data, there may be like a mix up between data depending on the context that you're looking for, especially through social media and such.
I would say that NLP processing isn't good enough yet, so it can't actually get the full semantic reasoning of why you're or of what you're looking at.
Yeah, so fundamentally, what does it take to search anything? Very simple question. I think everybody should know. What is a
large database and correlation between them? So right, I would say,
what is the technique called?
What's the technique called?
Mm-hmm. To get to a particular data element when you search, what does it use?
Search engine.
Yeah, what does search engine use? What is the fundamental technique behind search engine? The most basic.
Keyword. EFIDF retrieval.
Indexing. Right. And you have all this data, and then you go through the data and create the index, and then you search. But if it's a streaming data is just coming in. You can create index on them, but it is very hard, very difficult, right? So there's a diverse set of data coming in and you want to be able to search them. That is extremely hard. So creation of index on streaming data is particularly challenging thing, and doing it on large data would take massive computational power that would be able to do that in real time, right? So theoretically, you can. In a more controlled circumstances with the right infrastructure, you can. But when you have just data coming at you, then you can't really do that easily at all. Okay, Now, the second point I made. What one fundamental point that I made here is something called abstraction, that when people are thinking about something, the way they think about something and the way the data is represented, there is a gap between them. So I believe that in among the things that you were exposed to, did you come across the example of a blizzard? About in the cyber physical system, did you come across the example of blizzard? Okay, so think about you are in a very think about you being in a very cold area, and there is a you know, pretty bad weather, and then you ask, is this a blizzard, or would there be a blizzard today? What is involved that? Essentially, you need to resort to the definition of blizzard, and you need to understand that a blizzard is defined as active precipitation of X number inches of snow per 1 hour or per time period. Rule one. Rule two, visibility of less than half a mile. And number three, wind speed of more than 25 miles per hour. Right. So the point here is that you can look at particular data. What is the speed or wind speed? Well, you can say how fast the snow is coming down. Snow may be coming down very fast, but the wind is not there. It's not, it ain't be a blizzard, right? So people are, you know, you are interested in abstraction. Blizzard is not a physical thing. It's a defined thing. And you are interested in the abstraction of blizzard based on the real world value of wind speed and precipitation and such. Okay. So very often, then there's another very simple example. You as a human would be interested, should I wear a jacket today or not? Is it cold enough to wear a jacket or not? It does not. The machine or the sensor is able to tell you whether the temperature is 31.1 degree or 32.5 degrees. But for the human, it doesn't matter. Either of them is cold enough in the same range that you are going to want to have a jacket to go before you go out. Right, so that's abstraction. The abstraction that is meaningful to the human. Right? So we have to understand there are, you know, in some of the research we do, there are three fundamental concepts that we look for when we want to build systems that are meaningful to human. Remember, in the first class, we talk about computing for human experience. The three things that we are interested in, one is context. So you are talking about your suppose you're talking about whether I should eat this or not eat that, right? In one case, the context should be what is more tasty for you. But in some other case, if you have diabetes, your context could be which one would break your blood sugar, quota. So that's very different, right? So it is very important when you want to make a decision, what is the context in which the decision has to be made? The second thing we talk about is personalization. that for this person, eating that food is perfectly fine, but for this person, eating that food is not good. And the third thing that we talk about, which are very important, are abstractions. That the concepts that are meaningful for me to make decisions. At some point, maybe I'll give you this, or let me give you this example, if I've not already given, that for some medical applications, so we are working on ADHF, acute decompensated heart failure, which is basically heart failure. Blood pressure is a very important factor there. And so we measure, we have sensor with Bluetooth built into that, and the sensor gives us some result. The result, let's say, is 150. That's what sensor gives you. And then if you look at the sensor on the application, so that is data. But if you look at the on application, you say 150 mmHg systolic blood pressure. Then you, that is information. Then you look at the medical protocol or medical knowledge and say, what does this 150 mmHg means? And it will tell you that it is elevated blood pressure. It is a blood pressure in the range that needs to be treated or managed with medication or lifestyle change or whatever. But that is still not good enough for a doctor to choose the medication that he would prescribe to you. For that, he needs to know whether it is hyperthyroidism or hypertension. There are two different diseases. Both of them can cause elevated blood pressure. So that is the abstraction. Data, 150, to abstraction that on which you can act upon, right? Actionable thing. So these are very interesting things that we need to be able to, support in building intelligent systems that can play with, can interact with humans.
Dr. Shet, I have one question. Say we build these things, right? Like you said, let's say for the stock market, we build something that in terms of abstractions says that price to earning ratio is something, the company fundamentals is something, the economics is something, right? And then you decide whether or not to invest in that company. But that is horribly wrong in, say, last week's scenario, where somebody on Reddit just decided to short stock something and drive up GameStop or AMC stock. So our semantics in this case captured business fundamentals, but it did not capture user behavior.
Yes.
If we are developing an application that says that we are trying to recommend, say, what stocks to buy, we should probably incorporate user behavior, but we didn't this time, say, much like a hedge fund. So how can semantics help us there?
Well, what is the semantics here? And
in text, in Reddit conversation, there's a lot going on. Yeah. From that, we can develop semantics, right? That is not traditional to how an investing strategy plays out. But so that is the point of AI, right? We can, if somebody is relying on an advisor, a financial advisor to invest, then they don't need AI. But if AI is able to say something that they cannot, then how can semantics help us there? Neural networks can help us there in the sense that they can say some words are important versus not, but how can semantics help us?
Well, so semantics is meaning and use. So let's take the example. Where is this thing? Okay, I am going to share. Okay. Can you look at this page here, Cognovi Labs?
Yeah.
This is the company I founded in 2016. And what does this company do? It understands emotion in content. We started, when I founded the company, we were focused on emotion in social media content, right? And there is a very closely related thing here of sentiment. So when I use this technology, the non-commercial version of this technology is called Twitteris, and there's a lot of information on Twitteris, Twitteris online, if you go. So it will, it has a dashboard, and you can see in real time the volume, sentiment, and emotion, and location, and other things, right? So there is a similarity between stock decision making versus election outcome. So I was working on predicting election outcome for 2016 election, right? And if you go to my LinkedIn, and let me show you actually what it looks like, and then how you know, again, the word semantics have been used in many different ways. But let's see here. So this is kind of, you can see the dashboard that I had available. So it talks about this Cognovi powered by Twitteris technology resulting from my previous center. And here you are seeing, for example, what I would see in real time. And what you saw, you know, is that there was a lot more sentiment in favor of Trump and not in favor of Clinton, with also support of value that allowed me to predict at 1 o'clock that Florida is going to Trump. And then so this is how the dashboard looked like. You can see the volume here. Let me see if I can so this is volume, this is sentiment, and this is emotion, this is network, who is influencing whom, this is location, these are on the things on the various topics, and this shows you whether it is a bot traffic or a human thing, as well as some other things. And here you can see the issues on what topics and some other things like that. So, you know, I was able to, so when I make this call, when I did this call, I had a lot of things, not just the tweet themselves and their content, but their sentiment, their emotion, their connections, what topics drive them, and large number of things of that nature, right? So so you can see here, I predicted you know, the Alabama Senate election, and in that case, Doug Jones won, and the, you know, you have different sentiment, emotions, joy, sadness, disgust, anger, and different implication of the choices humans make in calling it a, you know, supporting this or not that, right? So in the human decision making is very complex. And what you need to take away from this is that you can't just depend upon the words that human uses. You have to look emotion behind it, sentiment behind it, influence behind it. And that is what makes for the intelligent system. Again, going back to our very start of the course, Computing for Human Experience, if you want to be, the whole general idea is that we want to be intelligent, we want to be able to support, be smart enough and behave similar to what humans can do. And you can't rely on just the words that are used. One very good example is that we were, we've done extensive work on cursing in social media. There have been number of, you know, I think I probably talked about it in last class, that there have been articles in Time magazine and BBC News, you know, and other places where we showed how much prevalence of cursing is on social media. And then we did work on harassment on social media. And we learned that the words are used in different ways. For example, the you know, some people had you know, claim that if people are using curse word, that means that could be harassing. It's not the case. In among teenagers, large amount of teenagers use curse words to each other, but that does not actually have negative meaning, right? You are hot doesn't mean you are hot. You are, you know, and the you know, teenager, you know, one girl tells other girl you bitch. That is not used in a negative way necessarily. In most cases, it is used in a way to kind of endearing way. Okay, so this makes it very hard. And so we have to understand the context of the use of that term, perhaps even resort to Urban Dictionary. In fact, very interesting is that for the same word that is used, the interpretation of the word, the meaning of the word, is different in US than in France. And so so we had to look up, and so there is something called Urban Dictionary that actually captures how various terms are used, or what is the meaning of those terms in different geographical areas, different countries. That can give you better, you know, if you know that that is a French person using that term in France, it means this. But an American in America or visiting France doesn't mean that, right? So these are the interesting and challenging things. And what it tells you now, if I were to step back, you know, make is that a lot of things that we do in computer science is way too simplistic. But the humans are a lot more complex. And hence, we really, and what we call as intelligence is very hard to define and is very hard to achieve. And when you talk about intelligence, most of the AI has talked about intelligence in a very narrow way. For example, oh, I can classify whether this thing is in this class or that class. Or I can, you know, predict based on all this data. Now, if you have data from sensors, it's possible that the data has no corresponding human attributes because the sensors on physical things are probably don't have emotion tied to it, so less complexity. But what if I have a sensor that measures stress? So there is something called galvanic skin response, and that is used to measure stress, and stress has effect on health, right? So now what do you do if a sensor is actually measuring human part? Now, other aspects of emotion and other things may be very, very valuable. So in the simplistic context where you have machine data, machine generated data, and you do a prediction, your machine is intelligent to some way because it's able to understand the pattern and come up with result that is important. For example, sensors are measuring vibration in HVAC system as a way to predict whether the system might break down, right? So the machines are for example, vibration on the airplane engine is a very important parameter, and vibrations is measured throughout the flight, and then it's analyzed at the end of the journey, and that is just one of the many parameters that is used to decide whether it is time to service the engine, maintain the engine in the maintenance shop, disassemble and grease it and whatever they do, right? So in those kind of contexts, it's you can make it intelligent in the sense that it gives you very good indication, fairly accurate indication on how accurate in decisions that you to make whether to service an engine or not. But in other contexts, when especially the decision making involves human psychology or behavior, it's damn hard. And those are the kind of things that so coming back again to the general theme of the class, when we think about building AI systems and or intelligent systems, we really have to ask these pretty challenging questions. And when you want to build the systems that ultimately support human decision making and or react to human provided, constructed, created data, is damn difficult. But that's why in a class, one class after the next, we are going to talk about the vision of semantic, cognitive, and perceptual computing. And there I will bring in some of this issue and at least one way of thinking about it. It's also tied to a very, another term that is used called brain-inspired computing. So, we are doing the decision-making based on understanding both of neurological thing as well as cognitive science, aspects. Very different, right? Psychology and neuroscience. And we are building things increasingly based on those, factoring many of those things to make the systems more intelligent. There is there was a panel yesterday. There was a presentation yesterday where from IBM the presenter talked about. System versus one versus system two. So there's work that economists did in behavioral economics, and he talks about the brain decision or decision making that acts very fast. Human perception, it happens automatically. You're watching something, and your brain immediately decides what the heck you are watching. Versus deciding, should I go for, so that is called system one. And that is very fast, but it is very error prone also. Versus system two, which is deliberate decision making or reasoning. So you're trying to decide, should I call, the grocery delivery? It'll cost me $15 more, or I should go to the grocery store in spite of raging coronavirus. And you will think, and it may be back and fro, and you'll make a call. And the decision making is not that microsecond it is, or millisecond it is, seconds or more, right? You might take minutes even to decide this. So, or you might mull on it, that you can sift through it and then decide it, right? You may be starting to think about it today, even though your grocery run is only 2 days from now, right? That's system two. So, and similarly in bio in cognitive science, there is something called top brain and bottom brain. And those concepts also bring in. So again, a lot of current research in AI is bringing multiple disciplines together. That also happens to be one of the areas of strength of the AI Institute and the work that my group does. Okay, so let's go back to our conversation,
Dr. Sheth, I have a question.
Yeah.
So the abstraction that we talked about, why hasn't it been implemented by any of the big tech companies? For example, the Blizzard abstraction that we talked about, it is still not implemented in the weather app and any of the big tech companies as of now.
Yeah, you're making very good points. So let me again tell you this little story. Some of the work that big tech does is very groundbreaking, but some of the work that they do, they really follow. So you remember that I asked you to read this article, right? The 15 year of semantic thing. You guys went through that, right? We discussed this, right?
Yes.
So, we did this work in era, you know, I had a commercial system built in year 2000, but it took Google, until 2013 to come up with its own semantic search. See, we did this searching here, and I have talked about in this paper, this semantic search that we had built. But Google did not have semantic search until 2013. So it is very routine that, and that's the difference, right? That many bright ideas come either in academia or in small companies, startups. By the time it goes to big company, it takes a lot of time. So I wouldn't say that Google people are dumb at all. They are very smart people. But they don't, first of all, have lock on the innovation. Very often the innovations happen in the small companies or academia, and then they borrow. In most of the things that Microsoft has done and Apple have done, they were never been the companies to come up with those ideas first. They are second or third after the idea has taken the after the idea is seen to be valuable and there are customers and they figure out that you can make money by implementing those ideas, then they will jump in. Until then, they won't. So there are reasons why the companies don't jump in. There are reasons that the companies don't necessarily have the brightest people. Companies don't necessarily have big companies don't necessarily have a lot of freedom. They have a lot of bureaucracies, right? While at a small company like that, this company, I had a research project in my university. I was convinced from the research project that this search kind of thing would be valuable. And so I went to venture capital and got them, showed them a demo, got the money, and hired some of my former students and got started with the company. So we could come up with this thing very fast. It would take much longer in big company. They would do due diligence. They would bring in business people to make the choices. They'll make big teams, all kinds of stuff, right? So they can't work on intuition or new idea that fast. So that is a general answer to your question. Any other question? Okay, I want to just bring up a couple of things before ending up on the topic of class three that we have not really completed fully. So one thing that you need to understand, and which is very important as you go through what I wanted you to get from the cyber physical social systems let's see what slides are these. One very important thing that's happening, and actually, let me take, let me see if this is here or not. Yeah. Here. What you see here is data at the bottom here. And then you have also dynamic data. But the semantic approach is very useful when you want to combine data from multiple sources. So in this particular slide, what we are trying to do is to show you broad variety of data. And then what we I'm showing here is a whole variety of on the right hand side here, ontologies or knowledge graphs. And what happens is that in the a semantic approach can help you more easily connect variety of data. I'll give you one example. Let's hope that you'll be able to visualize that. In 2008, in 26 November 2008, the day I started working on the Twitchy system, that by the way became commercial company in 2016, 8 years later, terrorists had struck India, Mumbai city. And basically, you are getting a lot of streaming data on Twitter and on Flickr images, and then and also of course news data. Now, a person who takes a photograph as well as tweets that photograph in the tweet, use of semantics is very valuable. For example, there is a building in Mumbai called Nariman House. And for a person who tweets near Nariman House, I can use the tweet metadata to say, oh, this came from near Nariman House. And if the person says just the word Nariman, not Nariman House. Now, Nariman by itself is very ambiguous. It can mean a lot of different things. But by using the location, I can identify that is Nariman House very likely. And then I have a photograph of Nariman House, the building itself. I can connect the image and the text much better through the use of knowledge graph or knowledge. It may be location knowledge. It may be a knowledge of building database and whatever else, right? So what is happening is one of the huge benefit that humans have, that our brains have, it has to do with the fact that our brain is amazingly good in taking data in various form and seamlessly collect it, right? So right now, your brain doesn't have to work hard to think that, the speaker had this gesture, the speaker had this emotion on the face, the speaker said these words, or the speaker said this slide, this image, text, video, words, emotions, everything can be connected in your brain together. And you don't have to work hard to do that. This is called multimodal sensing, right? Machines are not good at that. For many years, we have built vertical systems for just image processing. And we have different deep learning technique for image processing than text processing. We might use LSTM or we might use some other technique for some reason for text. When we might use CNN for image. Our brain doesn't have to worry about I use this algorithm or that algorithm and so on and so forth, right? Why? We don't know exactly for sure, but one possible reason is that our brain is not acting upon just data. It's converting the data into abstraction and connecting all of them. So the Nariman House is an abstraction. And then Nariman text or Nariman House's image are data. They have been connected at a higher level of abstraction. right? And that makes our brain very unique. And hence this semantic, cognitive, and perceptual framework that I talk about elevates the computational framework to incorporate these abstractions, making it possible for analyzing a lot of diverse data in decision making. All right. So I guess in the next class we will really go to the knowledge graph. So I have already posted the things for this class, which will continue in the next graph. Please read all of those materials and come ready to discuss it. The whole idea is that I don't want to repeat whatever in the slides and text is. You need to read them, but I would rather do the discussions and go and discuss the topics beyond what can be, what is in those texts and what is on those slides. Okay. All right. So much for this class. Somebody told me after the last class that officially the class should end around 3:15 or 3:20 rather than going to 3:30. So today I'm, because if we start with the next topic of knowledge graph, it'll take, we won't be able to get much into it. But please come ready so that at least what you'll see is that for every class, I give you a required reading material and an optional material. You are expected to read the required material or watch the required material, and I'll be asking the questions everyone one after another to see whether they are attentive and involved, which can reflect your grade. We'll meet again next week then. Bye.
Thank you, Professor.